Hello everyone. It's wonderful to have Azadeh Fatehat here. I'm going to read you some of her kind of past CV and stuff and bio. She went to Tehran University from 2004 to 2008 to do her PA. And then she was at Chelsea College of Art from 2010 to 2011 for her MA, and from 2011 to 2016 she did her PhD at the RCA. Dr. Azadeh Fatehat is an artist and curator based in London. Her research engages with the feminist history of Iran from 1909 to the present. Fatehat has made extensive use of archive material, including those held at the Weltkulturen Museum, Frankfurt am Main, the International Institute of Social History, Amsterdam, and the Institute for Iranian Contemporary Historical Studies, Tehran. This allowed her to develop new insights into Iran's women's movement and devise a related series of public programs, including exhibitions, conferences and workshops. As part of her research, Fatehat has curated a series of public programs, symposiums and exhibitions, including the exhibition Hang Damay Golestan, Witness 1979 at the Showroom London, as well as the Feminist Historiography at IAXIS Stockholm. She has presented academic papers at a variety of conferences and symposiums, such as the Neo-Traditionalist Representation of Women in Post-Revolutionary Iran, Moderna Musée, Moderna Musée Stockholm, Communal Social and Interpolitical State of Curatorial Practice at Sharjah Art Foundation, UAE, Movie Pictures and Photo Plays, New Perspectives in Silent Cinema at the University of York, and Challenging Gender, Embracing Intersectionality at Kingston University, London. Fatehat has exhibited her work internationally in London, Vancouver, New York and Tehran, and she's currently teaching in the Photography Department at the Royal College of Art. Welcome.
Thank you. Hi everyone, thank you so much Andrew for your kind introduction. And thank you so much for Slade School of Arts for having me here. It is a great pleasure to share my project with you, and it's wonderful to see so many of you in this room. But before I start, I like very active audience. So as we go along, you should write down your question, and when I finish, I like your hands up to see your questions. Don't go quiet, and just take note as we go, please. For the time being, there is a simple task that I'd like you to raise your hand if you have heard of practice-based research. That's a very good number, and if you're interested to do one, practice-based research. Not just after your slate education, but maybe sometime later. I didn't see the hands. Okay, perfect. That's very good. Fantastic. So I successfully completed a practice-based research at the Royal College of Art and received the prestigious award of unconditional pass. If you might be familiar with the process, this is a unique and rare result. Here I am to share with you my project or somehow my journey, and perhaps provide you with an insight to how an artist could contribute to written history, or how could personal, analytical, or imaginary could provide a different way of looking at time, whether it's past or present, or reflect on a socio-political concern, the way in which artistic production could respond, reflect to, and to an existing history. I have prepared a paper that keep me on time, and I'll take your time about 40 minutes, and as Andrew kindly noted, there is a time for question and answer afterwards, which I'd like to see your hands on. James, how can I turn this light up, please?
Councilor Tucker.
Is that good for you all? Yeah, okay. So there you go. Yes, my research, curatorial and artistic practice are all intertwined around the process of gathering information and generating new imagery. From the still and moving image in response to the archive material I discover. My multidisciplinary practice ranges from still and moving images to fictional stories, short films, artist book, and performance. I was greatly influenced by an image of the 1979 Iranian Revolution. Is anybody speak Farsi in the audience? No, okay. Which was the driving impulse behind my PhD practice at the RCA. The photo, as you can see here, it captured one of the most important days in the history of feminism in Iran. I was fascinated by this photo and the spontaneity of this demonstration, which I'm going to tell you about it in a bit later today. But I was very curious to find out more about myself and about the women of my society. For this project, you will notice that I have adopted a cross-cultural approach throughout this historical research, looking at the artistic, social, and political implications of the existing image and the relation to life today. But before I move further, I'm just briefly going to show you what happened to the media representation of this event, which is somehow the version that I grew up with in Iran. Here we have here, this photo, yes, is taken by Pengam Ebelistan on the 8th of March 1979. We go through this a bit later, but before that I'm going to show you this one. The figure one was taken during the 1979, the figure one and then the figure two. Present a historical narrative of women's appearance in post-revolutionary Iran. These are typical scenes that people like myself, growing up in Iran at the time, would often come across. The anniversary of the Iranian Revolution, which falls in winter and is known as Bahman 22nd, sees the various media channels broadcasting images of victory in Iran to help the new generation learn about the event. This is how I learned the sequence of events in my country's history. So, figure one was taken during the 1979 revolution itself, when men and women stood against the Shah, which was the previous regime with the government before, and to try to establish a more democratic country. They fought together for one united aim, and that was to essentially topple Reza Shah's government. As you can see, there is a mix of different fashions visible in the image, both a scarf, an unscarfed woman wearing long shirts, jeans, or other attire. In contrast, a very clear uniform can be seen worn by all men in the second photograph, the black from head to toe, which now represents the Islamic State of Iran. This image was taken after the establishment of the Islamic Republic in 1983 in Iran. So we have here the both images, the Iranian Revolution one and then afterwards. By looking at these two photos, it is understandable how one might assume there was simply a change between uncovered and covered women. The missing part of this narrative is that the transition was far, far from smooth, and that a six-day demonstration in fact took place against the new government, which was a revolt within the revolution, took place. This is the missing photograph in this narrative. One can see a large crowd demonstrating on the streets of Tehran. This significant demonstration, which saw about 100,000 men and women marching spontaneously throughout the streets, continued for 6 days. It is considered one of the most important movements in the history of feminism in Iran. During the first few days, women were just using small pieces of papers to write their very rudimentary slogans on. But by days 4 and 5, they were using curtains or markers, pens, and being far more effective. as some of you may know, on the 8th of March 1979, just 24 days after the Iranian Revolution, the compulsory dress code for women was announced by Ayatollah Khomeini, which is the supreme leader. I mean, he passed away, but it was the supreme leader. Soon after the revolution, there were in fact rumors of plans for reintroduction of the hijab and the abolition of several women's rights, which had previously been protected by the Family Protection Act, the reason being that they were seen as being against Islam. Now I'm going to show you a short video about the demonstration that is the only video documentation of this event. It was filmed by a group of French journalists called Practic Politique Salganes, you will see the title of the minister name, who documented the process using a 60mm camera and also conducted interviews with the demonstrators in that time. So I'm going to just see here and find the video.
Je veux pousser la naissance d'un mouvement de libération de femmes dans les dernières années. Dès le premier jour et pendant plusieurs semaines de révolution de femmes, quatre d'entre nous ont fait avec elles en ligne. Manifestations, soutiens, discussions, réunions. Et nous étions nombreux à Paris, Lyon, Bordeaux, Marseille et d'autres villes à mettre toutes nos forces à faire connaître leur mouvement. Nous avons transmis jour après jour leur revanche, leur fête, leur violence, leur victoire. Nous, les femmes du mouvement de libération des femmes, pratique politique et psychanalyse, qui affirmons que quand les femmes iraniennes brisent leur chaîne, ce sont les femmes du monde entier qui avancent avec elles. Le mouvement, c'est ni un jour de l'Est, ni un jour de l'Ouest, c'est un jour mondial.
But just to keep on time, I need to move on. But if you're interested to see, I can pass it on over the link so you can have a look at the press. So even though the national media largely ignored what was happening during those 6 days, the event attracted a great deal of international press attention. The movement was greatly supported and joined by feminists from France, Germany, Egypt, and many other countries, all of whom were anxious to lend their support to Iranian women. This led to the creation of a solidarity committee, which was led by Simone de Beauvoir. Here you see a copy of an image in F magazine, which captured this creation of the solidarity committee. At the time of these protests, the American feminist author, Kate Miller, was among the audience, was in Iran, attending a conference at Tehran University for International Women's Day on March 8th. And I'm going to show you a short video of her among the audience.
J'ai jamais vu des femmes qui s'organisent aussi rapidement et en aussi grand nombre. Il y a 10, 15 000 femmes dans ces manifestations. Aux États-Unis, ça prendrait des années pour se rassembler comme ça. Il faudrait de l'argent, il faudrait écrire aux gens, il faudrait la publicité. Ici, quelqu'une brandit un panneau pendant la manifestation avec sit-in à la télévision, ou bien demain au ministère de la Justice. Et tout le monde y va. Parce que ces femmes non seulement ont été réprimées pendant très très longtemps, mais ce sont aussi des femmes qui ont fait la révolution. Elles ont été dans les rues, elles savaient qu'elles-mêmes pouvaient être tuées par le chat et ses troupes. Ce sont celles qui ont le courage de sortir face au char, le courage de se soulever. Et beaucoup de femmes ont dit que pour leurs droits, elles pourraient se faire tuer, ça ne fait rien, la lutte doit continuer. Je n'ai jamais entendu des féministes dire des choses pareilles.
As you could see, she stated that she was extremely impressed by women's uprising, noting in her interview that in America, a demonstration of that scale would require many years of planning and writing to women to try and persuade them to take part, This had never happened before in the history of feminism, that women came out in the street spontaneously. So that was the story of my found image, as you will notice. I became fascinated with this image, and I wanted to know more than what was immediately or stereotypically available. I wanted to know more about myself, about women of my society. And the exciting part here began. I embarked on a PhD practice base at the Royal College of Art to pursue my passion and enthusiasm. I should also tell you that my encounter with the photograph was of the women's uprising, the one you can see by Hema Begolistan here, took place during my MA at Chelsea College when I attended a book launch and saw this image when flipping through the book. Being an artist, researcher, and curator enabled me to create, respond to, and restage the historical material with my new findings as I was going along. I started to do a series of fieldwork and research to articulate a more precise narrative of this woman's uprising. I received funding from the RCA to travel to Berlin and invest on an archive which is held there for feminist movement of Iran in diaspora. During the 6 days demonstration of 1979, indeed a community took shape to lead the activities that was called National Unity of Women. You can see on top part is National Unity of Women, and that National Unity of Women, one of the founding members was Shahin Nawahi. She established this archive in Berlin, which hold all the activities they were doing and also activities that they were following after they moved out from Iran. So one of the founding members of the community had created this archive in Berlin to preserve the documents as well as providing source for researchers and public program. This is Shahin and it's her office. As you can see, it's lots of shelves full of documents, magazine or material that they used during those times. This is the magazine which was published by National Unity of Women as part of their activity during those times. And here, as you can see, there is a shelf. Yes, I said the lifespan of the National Unity of Women was 8th of March 1979 to April 1983, when the enforcement of the dress code was in full force, and ultimately the members had to escape the country. Some of them immigrated to Britain, some in Stockholm, Sweden, or Germany, Berlin, as you can see, and US America, among others. I did a series of interviews with Shahin Nawahi, and to record her insight on the 6 days demonstration, as well as the activities they did during those times. So here you can see some of the images, and we have prepared for you a short video. Here she's going to talk about the magazine I showed you as slash.
Close this office. probably be when they come in and then they go out.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they were discouraged. The building was about eight stairs more, and it was a lot of office there, there was a lot of people they were going and coming. And for this season, we didn't have a good cover.
Yeah.
And in this time, that we found out in our reorganization, reorganize ourselves, we find out that the women are not really attracted to the newspaper.
So I'm going to stop here just to catch up with you. I just wanted you to see what format a field board would take. We can do an interview and that would say as a source material of the facts that you can investigate in your research. Then I started, after this time, I started to work with photographs, and in collaboration with the showroom in London, I started to illustrate the happening in the form of an exhibition. Here you can see that I traveled back to Tehran with the photojournalist Hena Mehrostan to visit her archive. We chose together a few negatives. I scanned the selected ones. Some of them, the one on the top left, you can see that's the original photo I encountered, and the archive, which is a few. And yeah, we did a series of tests for it to combine the traditional fine art as well as the vinyl prints on the wall of the gallery. I'm assuming that you're all familiar with the showroom, right? You've been in showroom before? I can't hear you.
Yes.
Yes, okay. So showroom is a non-profit space located in Edgware Road, which is sort of a Middle Eastern primarily. And their work is very much to do with community projects and working with neighborhood. Given this framework, I wanted to use the most of the available communication with neighborhoods. I started to use a different print format that could be displayed outside the billboard, but also not much of the cost effect. So here you can see we were just trying to find the right dimension for the prints. And here is how normally showroom uses the billboard outside. I made it to this because I wanted to cover all the wall, and I wanted when people passing by to be attracted to get engaged, to be asked to come in or ask about what is this photos. And as you can see here, I scanned them in a way that the mark of this Kodak negative is still visible. So you could reference to the manual photographer because at that time this was not very much, it was not a digital photography when she used it. But us digitalizing it, I didn't want to remove her trace of coming from that far background. As you can see here, just to keep the cost down for your practical financial tips, we wanted to, we wouldn't be able to print all at once. It would be very expensive. So there is a space in Houston, near Houston, it's called Service Point. Have you been there before?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very good. It's very good cost, very reasonable price. And what the guy did for us, we cut it out in three parts, so three lines, and then we put it up like three of them together, sort of we mashed on the lines together, so we could keep the cost down very cheap. And we could still have the results we wanted. This is something we are all quite familiar with in art school, right? From the interior, have you been in this show, any of you? That was last September. No? No. Okay. For the interior, I placed a table in the middle that displays the books that has enriched my research. And also different format of the prints was displayed on the wall. The exhibition, as you can see, the table with the books, different vinyl prints on the left side, and then there's a vinyl print, and then I scan some of the photos in sort of to go as a slideshow, just to have a little bit of more technology going on rather than just all the photos on 2D. The program was accompanied by a series of public, the exhibition was accompanied by a series of public programs to unfold the topic further. So, such as a screening, workshops, symposium, and reading groups. Here,
you can see some of the workshops. Some of them we did in the site, which was at the showroom. Some of them also I coordinated at the Corso Union Foundation. That should have been there. You should have been there, right? Corso Union is your contemporary partner. These are some of the images of the workshop we did. We primarily did collage and photos to create new images of the existing one that was available. And that is Louise Sherry on the left side. I co-curated with her. She is the curator of the collaborative projects in the showroom. I don't know the other guy. But that's what I could find in my image to share with her. She's lovely. If you get a chance to work with her. This is images of the symposium. You met Shani a few minutes ago. We invited her over from Berlin to talk in the symposium. We had 2 days symposium going on, one in the start of the program and one somehow towards the last week of the program to bring together academics, artists, and people from all the field. And this is a photo. Some more of the workshops. Do you do workshop over here with communities or neighboring? Yeah? No. It's an interesting part to develop if you're interested in archive photos, because suddenly your photo turns out something else. Somebody's cycling outside, or it's something totally different. It's an interesting way to expand. It was very rare to see, but actually this is a private view photo, so it was very rare to see. But during the week also, we had a very good a number of audience coming over, as you can see here. And it was well covered by the press, British Journal of Photography, Guardian, Financial Times, Generously, the Daily Press, New York Times, CNN, Euronews did an interview they filmed in this space. And that's actually what remains after the exhibition. How it's been well received, how people have communicated with it. Do push on that if you're interested to pursue your practice seriously. These are some of the press copies for you here that you have copied. So it was here in this time that I became curious to know, okay, this is 1979, but what happened before that? Is that accurate what we know about the history of the before that, or that is also problematic? Or why women dress continuously came out to the street, and what was in state for us for that? That was the moment that I visited the archive in Tehran to find out more about photography record of the early feminism in Iran, which is around 1911. After a few months research, I should show you a photo from there. It's called IRCHS, International Iranian Institute for Contemporary Historical Studies. It stands for that. These are some of the photos of early 90s and early 20th century. And that's when the feminist movement in Iran began. So after a few months of research there, I was invited to International Institute of Social History to work on the archive of the founding mother of Iranian feminism, which is called Sari Redol Atalay. So I show you, these are images of Iran, Tehran archive. And then I was invited to here. International Institute of Social History is in Amsterdam. If you have any interesting project related to social science, social history, they have everything documented there, and they are very welcoming for any researcher, any interest, it's open to public, you need no further problem to get in, it's not that difficult there. They're very welcoming. So I started work there on the archive of the founding mother of Iranian feminism. She is called Sari Redol Atalay, and it goes back to early 20th century. As some of you may know, it was during the Constitutional Revolution. Have you heard of that? No? Constitutional Revolution was taking place in 1906, where the name Iran changed a great deal for women. It was the revolution which took place in early 20th century and was based on the need for representative government, educational reform, and modernization, were all among the objectives of the constitutionalists. This was a great time for women awakening. would pave the way for the creation and development of the modern Iran. A group of educated and enlightened women, including Sayyed Rabi'a al-Abadi, the one we are just talking about, played a very strong role in this time of awakening in terms of the school and society they founded, and the articles that they wrote and the journals they published. Yes, not to forget, I'm an artist doing all of this, so I have to make work as I go along. Not to just make happy my family, but also to create and respond to what I was working on. So here we're going to watch 4 minute video, which is somehow what I have gathered so far in that time. Yes.
But to highlight the initial purpose of the revolution, i.e. to secure greater freedom and equality for the people. The protesters were fighting for equal pay for men and women and for freedom of the press, speech and assembly. The aim of this remarkable spontaneous protest, the first of its kind in feminist history of Iran and indeed the world, was to protect their rights and autonomy of women away from the authority of the men who sought to force them to cover. collaboration with the National Institute of Social History, I curated a show in Amsterdam titled Iran's Women's Movement. Focusing some of the original archive as well as my photographs and video in response to this material. As you can see here, it was 5-channel video and photographs. And we also included the original documents borrowed from International Institute of Social History and placed them in the glass box there. And what you can see on the wall is a large of the original document to create more of a better coherence in this space. And on the right side, you can see the video we just looked at. It's the moment that Kate Miller is talking with in the Iran Revolution about the happening in women uprising. It was received by New York Times, and that was the only coverage. So now we are, yes. And here in my last section, our presentation, I'm going to tell you the most exciting part of my project. This is the time that I left the historical part to the form of a backdrop. Do you do photography here? Like a studio shooting?
Yeah.
So I started to work as a backdrop, and I started to find myself between these two worlds. The way in which I juxtapose these findings with personal, analytical, and imaginary dimension flourished to a new body of work. Even though the project started with the physical female body and forced physical way, but I shifted to a more invisible form of veiling. I started to see a shifting pattern of exclusion and inclusion, which was no longer a dichotomy of veiled, unveiled, us, them, indoor, outdoor, rather a form of juxtaposition of all those, a moment in between all of those. I realized that the physical veil might have been forced on women through a political or religious power, but the gesture, behavior, and worldwide views attached to years of wearing or not wearing it cannot be transformed so easily and overnight. I continued to dig more on this when I realized a text by Irene Wright, she's called Fatan. Oh, actually, I'm quoting the person, but the name is not correct. It's Farzanani. This text is by Farzanani. I apologize for the wrong quoting. But I read it for you. They have been veiled and unveiled by a force, but they will remain unfolded and covered by physical and sociological traces of their moods of acceptance or rejections of the veil. It was a true feeling to read this. It was me among different metaphorical forms of veil, which could be language, behavior, and many others, which are not traceable similar to the physical form. It was here, so I just repeat this, that was a quotation from Farzan Anilan. Here was the moment I received the grant. Any Swedish people in the audience? No? Okay, they were very generous. So I received a very good grant from IASPIS, which is called Swedish Arts Grants Committee, International Program for Visual and Applied Arts, to develop my research further in this part. And here, as you can see the images, I start to explore the idea of how in between I am, between these two cultures, between these two understandings. For example, in this multimedia installation, let me show you. This is the IASPIS, and that's how I was developing a project with my photos. Me indoor, outdoor, studio shooting, abstraction. Sorry, I'm going fast. And here is a multimedia installation. There is a 3-channel video and photographs playing simultaneously, displaying the position of in between. It could be a bigger TV, but this is how we could figure out at the end for the installation.
But if I'm going to do it again, it's an emergency. These are some of the photos you were looking at on the wall, but this is a more close-up image. This is actually my favorite. I'm doing a Christmas card. Christmas with this. Just to send to all of my supporters. Yeah, it's a bit chaotic here, but that's why we're inside. So. I like the backstage of the process as well as the final, because it's part of it. And here, yes. Following these experiments, I did a day symposium at the ASPIS in Stockholm. Speakers including Petra Dahl and Adriana Farrokhzad, and also Sister of Jan. You know Petra Dahl? No? Go to the Venice Biennale this year. That's really important, guys. It's a bit expensive, but it's really important you're present there. And that's where you see these people. Meet them, sorry. Or see their work. The project was called, the Feminist Historiography. It is the title. As part of this title, I did a as part of this program, I had a performance and a screening at the Index Foundation for Swedish Art and for Swedish Contemporary Art, and a performance which is called The Dining Table. It was in collaboration with Asa Sandbrick, if I correctly pronounce, Emily Johansson, Joanna Lombard, and Shiona Mao. The copyright of these images are from a studio, Alvaro Campo Studio. I wrote simply in a script, and by looking at the writing and poems in relation to sociopolitical changes concerning women's life. And it was inspired by the Iranian poet, woman poet. She was called Simin Behbahani. I started to work with these artists and rehearsing with them and putting notation on the board, on the text. I found female voice very strong and a great metaphor in my work, and quite powerful. I enjoyed the polyphony of the voice. Here I'm going to play for you a short part of the performance. While I would like to ask you to remain on the while I would remain on the scene image, I will play that. It's difficult to read from that. The program is fully recorded and available on YouTube, so because we wanted to disseminate the project further, so it was recorded. It's very good that you're also doing recording, because people can see why if they could not attend the program. Okay, we are here. And maybe I will ask you to close your eyes, or I will ask you to just look at the still image, because this really embraces you if you let it to come inside, if you let it to be with you. So yes, I'm going to play that, but I'm going to be in this image. So how can I do that? How do this?
Living empty of green memories. Oh, gypsy, with the jokes of liberty, stand yearning, gypsy, receive the masses, turn a message with their lips, yearning, that is the birdest yearning, you're the sheep of things, gypsy, draw the bark, make it a fire, stand at your teeth, gypsy. When my faith was hanging by the weak thread of justice, and the justice, the heart he has lives for being torn to pieces, for the childlike eyes of my father, the blindfold of our lost black kerchief, and the fountains of tears and the reaching forth, this is the temples of my desire,
disarming.
When my life was no longer anything, just nothing but the tips on the never walked to tell, I discovered that I must seek justice. Absolutely had to lie and
desire, desire.
One window you're not for me. One window to the moment of consciousness. silence.
So what's happening is that it's full enough to explain the meaning of the world to its meaning
of game.
Absolutely, as you say, sir, it did not appear but trembled under your feet, let me hear the
meaning.
Then, after evoking the images of atomic explosions and the exploration of oil, the speaker observed that
dream.
Dreams are so safe from the point of the naivete and I.
Dreams.
And smelling a 4-leaf clover that has grown on top of the great ancient concepts. What not the woman who turned the dust to each chastity by waiting and reacting with my curiosity? We ourselves climb the stairs with my curiosity.
Curiosity,
the good girls, pay silence of my house.
Thank you. So, here, what I have is a few images of I'm almost done, so don't worry. Thank you for your attention. Some of the images out there here as well. And we just watched this video together. And this is Moderna Museet in Stockholm. They kindly invited me for talking about this project that was done in Stockholm. I did, and also in there I also talked about the project in Amsterdam, because I think these are all kind of the one look. What I'm going to tell you is currently there are two books coming up around this topic. One is a monograph of my research, which is sort of my thesis going to be published. The second one is a collection of these speakers and artists I worked with. I asked them to contribute a text or their work, just going to be published next year. I'll send an invite for the book launch. Do come along. I'd love to see your faces. I remember your faces. What else am I going to see? Yes, I'm going to stop here, and I'm very curious to hear your questions. It could be a comment, reflection. Don't be shy. Do ask. I'd like to hear your voice. Thank you so much. So you're asking me if the voice over there, how the voice over there is in relation to the voice I work with when I put on a still image here?
Yes, yeah.
Yes. I'll tell you, the performance was really powerful. I was part of it and I was reading it. And after each performance and rehearsal, I felt I can do anything.
Yeah.
It was extremely powerful even to hear their voice. And even I found myself in a new part of my work, which I've never expanded that far. I was always in a 2D or maximum sculpture. I was a painter, I then started as a photographer. This was the journey. I never went that way of, okay, I say, now you read, now you. So I was a director in between of these. And it was so interesting to reach that core part of my being, which I have never felt before, that is, How do I know when she should stop? How do I know when I want that voice? It was a very very important experience for me, as myself, in my self-journey. And I'm developing that. I did a series of projects with the Laban Center for Music and Dance, you probably know them, as a performance, to develop the gestures in these protests and demonstrations, or how the media could capture you as a whole body, and how performance could reflect on that. So, answer your question, I didn't want you to see the video when I'm reading it, because I feel shy myself. I don't want to see myself performing and being present. So maybe you look at it when I'm not there and see what you think. But and also, I think the image, the video, it disturbed the quality of the sound I was looking for. And the people were present there. Many of them afterwards came to me and said, we had to close our eyes as part of it. And then I realized, oh, actually, that works much better. So, that was... Did I answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, I hope so, thank you. Any more? Fantastic.
I'm Jean from the
Media Department.
Yeah.
That is also the School of Fine Art.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Sorry, not...
I was wondering if you presented this body of work or done any talks about practice in Iran recently, or so outside of a Western audience, and if so, or if not, what do you think, how differently do you predict the audience would take this body of work? Can you predict, I guess, perhaps we'll try to predict more of the questions that would come up if you did this back in Iran as opposed to white, Western, privileged women?
Very good question. Sure. So, as far east as I have gone with this project is Sharjah Foundation. Sharjah Art Foundation, they do every March a program which is called March Meeting. They bring all international curators or writers, or the most of them you very well know them. And they are present there for 2 days constantly, one after another, presenting, doing discussion. I was part of that, and that was the moment in Middle East I presented the project. Before that, that is last March 2016. Before that, or since then, I have not exhibited in this material in Iran, and you probably know the reason. So the image we looked at it as a, for the beginning of my project, this image is cut out of history book. The history of it, of that 6 day demonstration, is no longer available when I go out there. So the reason being is seen as not being something positive about the history of the Iranian revolution, because there was a revolution within the revolution taking place. So I won't be able to sort of go far with it in Iran. Since the Shogun project, which was covered by, which had press coverage at Euronews and the others, I've not visited home because I don't feel safe. And before that, I was visiting home twice a year. And as the archives you looked at it, I was visiting home to work on those archives, I was part of that community. I'm still very much keen on going back home visit, but I'm not 100% sure I can come out. And that's quite, it's not that clear for me yet. But answering your question, I'm not sure I can exhibit this material back home. I'm preparing an online platform in support of British Council. It's a bilingual online platform, English and Arabic, not Farsi, even though we can't really speak Farsi, but Arabic because it would cover larger audience, and about this project. So that could be accessible from any part of the world, my home country, or anyone who is interested in Iranian history or feminism in Iran, that could be done. The book I'm publishing is in two languages, Farsi, not Arabic, I'm sorry, and English, so it could be used back home. I don't know when would be the time that they could welcome the reality of the history, one day, hopefully. And and that will be for sure. That is for those people. I was very curious to know more, and I'm sure many women in my age or younger could be very interested to know more. So, answer your question. Maybe one day.
Not yet. Yes.
And I have one more.
Yeah.
The lady that you showed in the Germany.
Yes.
The researcher.
Yes, Jackie Navoy. That's her name.
She said a statement saying women are not very attracted to the newspaper.
Yeah.
So that's quite a sweeping statement to make. Could you explain why you think she said that? And was that in, like, way back then or now, or perhaps how it would be?
Sure. It was not. It's not related to now. The question to her was, how was that time with you, for your community? Her answer, I'm sure, should be about that time, which is 1979. She was active there. From the moment they announced the composer dress code, which we saw videos and photos, to the moment that actually we went on the enforcement, took 3-4 years. So 1979 was announced. But in action was 1983. So during those times they were active. This community of nationality of women was active and pursuing women's rights and keeping them together to fight for it. But they had to work hard to make women interested in newspaper or reading, or even though there has been many years, 50, 60 years before that, of working in that part by the first wave feminist movement of Iran. But in the afterwards, which is their time, they still had this challenge. What she's reflecting on is, even though that seems to be established, but yet we have to fight for, we have to encourage them to come to our session, to discussion, to read books or read the articles. So it's what she's expressing on taking on that is that it was not an easy, an academic community of, okay, we are all going to do the reading group and we are reading it together. No, they had to also fight for bringing them there and working with them. That's all I could reflect on. But I can leave my email to Andrew, and if you have any question on that, I can look up and get back to you. Or if you put my name, there is a website with email there as well. Come on. That should be easy, maybe. No?
Yes. Thank you.
Pleasure. Any more questions?
Fantastic. Hi.
I think we should wait for the mic. And I've seen your hand too, so after.
Thank you. Rosa Luxemburg said that, because you talked a lot about the spontaneity of that thing on the 8th of March, and Rosa Luxemburg talked a lot about spontaneity in her writings on her revolutionary experiences in Germany. And it was sort of controversial in Marxist discourse at the time, and some people interpreted it as almost anarchist. But I don't think that I think that most of the practice was sort of in line with Bolshevist ways of organizing. But I'd just be interested to know how we can learn from those women and that sort of spontaneity that happened there in the context of now. Because obviously they were fighting the counter-revolution over there, and we have many things to fight here in terms of the racist revenge strategy, the racism of the government over here, the misogyny of the government over here. Where I come from in Portsmouth, the Conservative Council was cutting refuge services for victims of domestic violence. There's a whole lot of stuff going on like that, and we've got to develop a way of finding those things effectively over here. It's not happening just yet, like organising as best we can, but not getting that sort of turnout that they were seeing over there.
Yeah.
That massive spontaneity, and what Kate Lillard was saying about how in the US stands over here, but it'd be very difficult to get those kind of numbers out, but it just sort of happened, because it's this sort of, that sort of pressure fosters naturally a response.
Yeah.
I guess it hasn't reached that point over here, but yeah, just wondering what we could learn from.
Yeah, sure. Very good question. It was very interesting for me also to learn, this was not an arrangement, they came out on themselves. And that's very significant on that. But also, when you can see the images of a spontaneous demonstration of 6 days, that has changed the format in today Iran. The today Iran is what I call aesthetic of resistance, which is a more form of the same protest, but in a form of aesthetic, in a form of fashion statement. And it's a different way of addressing the same issue. It's more subtle, or I would say more feminine. Because how far you can go by demonstration, or how strong your voice can go over by demonstration, where you have tools like internet, or where you have tools like fashion, to demonstrate that. So, for instance, in the case of Iran, it was 1979, woman demonstration. This form was the style to go about it. But when we have 2009, another demonstration, you can look at the images of the mixed fashion of a full cover woman with a full makeup on, with loose dress, with light on short garments, tight clothes, something that you would somehow rarely see in London Soho. But they were ready to express a sort of a exaggerated way of fashion dress code, which is imposed on them. So it's a different way of going about social concern. Or me as an artist, I reflect this way. So if we, I'm not sure I can respond to the Britain issue. And I'm aware of the difficulties and the way that could be addressed. But are we as an artist responsible to reflect the history or the happenings as they are, or are we able to offer a new way of looking at it and what that could be? Or what is the language we have that others don't have? How we can create a new way of looking at it that could open up to further discussion or compromise rather than direct or the protest? I'm not a protest person. And there was a lady in the back, sorry, thank you. And how we are doing with time on
we are okay. We should stop soon. Maybe one more question.
Oh.
Hi. I'm on the practice of PhD.
Oh,
And I thank you for bringing that amazing story, sort of a lost piece of history to us. Absolutely fascinating. But to bring it back to the Academy, I wondered whether I wasn't clear as to what your PhD project was within the work that you showed us. And related to that, I wondered if you could put your finger on your original contribution to knowledge within that.
Sure. For sure. Okay. My original PhD was the photo we looked at. It was began with the found image and how as an artist I could contribute to that missing part of history. It's Hal Foster in Archival Impulse has written on that. Quite a very short narrative, but he has addressed that. When we look at the history of the past, when we restudy it, how we respond to that, or how we... So by bringing that up, that was my beginning of the PhD. The title of my PhD is Photography, Desire and Resistance Following 1979 Iran Revolution. What you were watching here through the presentation was the journey I took as a practitioner who does curating, who creates. He curates show and creates work and does research. So these elements I try to put together that could be interesting for a fine arts student community. There are different chapters in my thesis that address different topics, which is maybe quite extensive for this 1 hour presentation. But I have done several conference work that has looked at them in more specific terms. The last one was last weekend at the Westminster University. It's called After Chantal Kerman, and they were 2 days of conference. The paper I produced there was in response to how we use those images or how we respond to the everyday life within those concerns of history or a woman in exile as myself. So these are the issues. My contribution to knowledge has been pretty extensive, and I'm proud of it, to tell you, which is those exhibitions you're saying I've done in 1 year. And the book publication is coming up. I'm not sure if you were in the salon when I talked about it. I have a monograph coming up this year, which is my PhD thesis. And I have a book publication of editing book from the speakers and artists I worked with responding to this project. And contribution to knowledge is, in my time, is when you can produce a way of looking at something that already exists. In my project, I did that. And what I produced was an exhibition, which was based on a community practice of series of public program. And we brought students from Manchester University, Brighton University, and St. Martin to our city to talk about those, to attend those conferences. And this was how I got funding to do my PhD. I promised certain outcomes, and that was my contribution, and I've done more than that. So I'm definitely sure I contributed better than I was expected to.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure.